Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined us today because I have Don Wenner here. He is the best-selling author of Building an Elite Organization, the Blueprint to Scaling a High-Growth, High-Profit Business, and he is going to talk to us today because he's had some amazing success in his own capital company, and I'm very excited to see what he learned from that business. So we will talk to Don, and we'll do that right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Don Wenner, who is the founder and CEO of DLP Capital, and he's also author of the latest book, Building an Elite Organization. It's so nice to have you here, Don.
Hey, it's an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for having me on today.
Oh, well, I was looking forward to this because I know you have done some amazing things. You have been ranked on Inc., 5,000 fastest growing companies in the U.S. I mean, I was looking at some of the awards you've won. You really had some great successes. And I know you deal a lot with real estate and other things, but your latest book is more of a general book. And that's great for my audience because you're talking about building an elite organization, which everybody wants. So I want to get a background on you, though, to just for people who aren't familiar with you, to say, you know, how did you get to this level and what led to you writing this book?
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you for that. So I'm the as you said, the founder and CEO of essentially a real estate company called DLP Capital. And I founded that company in 2006 when I was a college student at Drexel University studying finance. And I, like many, grew up in a very much, lower middle class working family, bought everything at yard sales. My parents had me at 16 years old. And I actually moved out of my parents' home in high school, and I was always really good at math and entrepreneurial. And so I decided early on in life, in eighth grade, actually, I was going to become a financial advisor. And that's what I went to Drexel thinking I was going to do. And of course, best laid plans, often don't work out the way you originally thought, and kind of stumbled into real estate essentially by mistake through a friend while I was still in college as a real estate agent at Keller Williams Real Estate in 2006. The month I received my real estate license, which was October 2006, was the peak of the real estate market. Literally that month was the peak in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, where I grew up. And so the market only went down for years. But the really great part about that is my marketing message from the very first day I had my real estate license was, your home sold guaranteed or I'll buy it. And I marketed that message everywhere, and it led to a lot of motivated home sellers when, it was a challenging market and we went through, the Great Recession. I had a lot of motivated home sellers who would contact me to sell their home, and I would either help them sell their home and remove the risk of the sale, or I would just step in and buy their home. And that led to me building an investment business, initially flipping homes. Built a construction company to support the home flipping business. Then at the bottom of the market, started building a rental portfolio and started doing property management. And we started launching private investment funds, bringing in individual, investors into our investment funds that were buying, distressed housing. And people call it family and friends money, but my family all worked for me and basically still do. And my friends were in their mid-20s. So there was no family and friends money, but, worked really hard. Anybody I could find with money, any leader in my community, any bankers and attorneys and accountants and doctors and so forth, and fought really hard to raise some money. And it started going well after, a couple years of a lot of hard work. And in 2014, time frame, I had about 100 employees, team members, as we call them, and we owned 700-800 properties. And we said, what are we going to do when we grow up? And decided on that our world revolved around housing, and more specifically revolved around providing affordable workforce housing. And so we decided to start buying large apartment communities, and that brought me to where I'm talking to you from today, St. Augustine, Florida, where I reside today. And we really focused on the Southeast. And then we also started lending money to other real estate investors. And so that's all grown really fast, and kind of fast forward to today where, you know, we're a real estate investment management company at our core, but we run basically 13 different businesses that work together to execute on providing workforce housing. And we have 450 team members. We do about $500 million in revenue. We've grown by 60% or more every year for 15 years, and been Inc. 5000, as you said, 9 straight years, and built a really phenomenal, you know, leadership team, and we're really excited on what's ahead.
Well, you know, that's an interesting story. I actually worked at Keller Williams in 2005, and before that I was a loan officer and an account executive in subprime before all that crashed. And as you were saying that, we just bought their houses, I was starting to think, where'd you get this money to buy all that? That's not exactly easy to do.
Yeah, it's a great question. And yeah, definitely was not easy to do in the beginning days. But, you know, when I got started, you know, in 2006, as you probably remember, you know, and because of the subprime days, you mm-hmm. know, everybody was a real estate investor, right? The stories of, you know, every waitress and taxi driver and so forth, right? Owned 4 rental properties. And so everybody wanted to be a real estate investor. So I started helping, you know, people find properties as a real estate agent. Mm-hmm. And one day I was sitting at a closing table representing a investor who's going to buy this home from this little old lady named Eleanor. And so I'm the real estate agent sitting across the closing table, and she's about 82 years old, and my buyer doesn't show up. And you know, half hour goes by, I'm trying to make small talk and keep calling him. His name was Frank, and he doesn't pick up. And finally, about a half hour, he picks up his phone, and I say, you know, where are you? And he says, well, I can't get my hard money loan, so I'm not buying the home. Click, hangs up on me. So I tell Eleanor that my buyer can't buy her home. And she breaks into tears. That she's. Do you want me to maybe re-say that?
No, that's fine.
Okay. So she breaks into tears, and that she's going to lose her assisted living facility she's in if she doesn't have the money today. So the house was $72,000. So I'm not exaggerating the story. I was actually sitting at the building, which is right next door to my headquarters in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, today. And my bank was literally, I could see it out the window of the closing table, PNC Bank that I banked at the time. And so I literally ran across the street, and I basically withdrew all my money, which was $72,000. I was, you know, 22 years old. I'd saved up $72,000 from literally selling alarm systems door to door, which was my job before real estate. And I bought this lady's home and didn't really know that much about what I was doing, but, you know, hired a good contractor and managed it well. And I made, you know, 20, 30 grand. Profit, and you know, and said, "Well, this wasn't that difficult," and started doing it more often. And I started finding, you know, local professionals who had known me from helping them, you know, buy or sell real estate, and I would get them to partner with me, help provide some of the capital, and that really started, you know, taking off to the point that we then started launching private investment funds soon after.
You know, it's an interesting industry. I loved being a loan officer. When I left, I wanted to just continue learning about that industry, and that's when I got my real estate license. I'm around people who make a killing in the, you know, commercial real estate. That's where you see some of the most you know, financially, you know, wealthy people out there. I mean, real estate's can be really good, but it's also scary for a lot of people. And I'm sure you've probably learned some hard lessons, and some of that. It's not always a good market, as we found out after subprime and all that. What did you learn from that you incorporated just the hard times to write your most recent book? Did that have any impact at all, the real estate?
Yeah, it's a phenomenal question. And so the reality is, the way I always think about it, certainly you're absolutely right that, you know, in a recessionary environment, you know, a lot of people got hurt in 2008, 2009, and that certainly is always a risk in any investment. But what I've learned over the years is that the real risk, you know, real estate investors or any business owners or leaders face is much less often external risk, such as, you know, an economic downturn, as it is internal risk of not being, you know, not running a disciplined organization that can handle, you know, turbulence. Mm-hmm. And that certainly is things like not having cash reserves or not having strong cash flow as some basics. But, you know, most cases when I find over the years, we've either acquired and or funded as a lender somewhere around 15 to 20,000 investment properties over the past 10 years.
Wow.
And out of all of those investment properties that have gone bad or had problems, almost never was the issue the real estate. It was almost always execution. It was almost always that the operator didn't hire the right people, didn't put enough, you know, structure in place, you know, didn't financially, you know, project cash flow effectively enough to for the duration of the investment. It was a lack of planning and discipline. And actually where, you know, my book came from, which, you know, as you said, is called Building an Elite Organization. The subtitle is The Blueprint to Scaling a High Growth, High Profit Business. And in 2014, when our lending business really started taking off, we started really helping a lot of investors in that all of a sudden now they had access to more money. So they were buying more properties and doing more deals. And that was really exciting for them and for us. But all of a sudden, we started having some of our very good borrowers go into defaults. You know, they couldn't make their loan payments. And almost every time, again, it wasn't the real estate was the issue. It's that they didn't put enough discipline, structure, organization in place to handle the growth. You know, the proverbial, incredible CEO with a bunch of minions or, you know, followers, a great individual, you know, CEO can get to a certain level of success, but if they don't develop their leadership, don't develop their team, don't put, you know, structure in place to handle communication and, you know, project management and so forth, they run into problems. So what started happening is we started helping these borrowers of ours implement what the book is about, our elite execution system, which is an internal operating system to how you go about hiring, how you go about developing leadership, how you go about communication, prioritization, how you build a clear strategy and direction and culture. And we started helping kind of on a one-off basis, these operators implement this system and, kind of write their business and get things back on track and realize there was such a need for it that it kind of led to us, you know, writing the book and, doing this we have a full business today that helps companies, real estate, and otherwise implement the elite execution system, put discipline in place and kind of the four quadrants of a business, as I call it, which are strategy, people, operations, and acceleration, which is sales and marketing combined. And what I find is that people who want to learn and want to grow and want to get better, which I'm going to assume most of the people listening fall into that category, who are curious and want to get better. There's so many gurus out there. And they tell you, you know, if you just get great at leadership, right, that's the secret to successful business. If you just get good at content marketing, or you just get good at having great strategy, or you just implement checklists, right, there's this one silver bullet that if you were just better at that,
right,
it would solve all your problems and you'd be able to grow a phenomenal business. But the reality is there's a lot of things that have to happen together as a part of one plan to get consistent growth. And that's why, you know, despite all the awards and such we won, the one I'm most proud of is that not that we've been on the Inc. 5000 list, like you mentioned, but that we've been on it 9 straight years.
Wow.
I've never been one of the 500 fastest growing companies. I've never been higher than 2,500. So every year for 9 years, we've been between 700 and 2,000 every year, year after year. We're the fourth fastest growing company in America that's made the list 5 or more times ever. We've been on the list 9 straight years. So the consistency is just about putting discipline into your organization that leads to, you know, consistent, incredible growth. We've grown by 60% or more for 15 years just by putting the right structure in place. That's what we're really passionate about and helping, you know, others be able to do, be able to grow businesses and create jobs and develop leaders.
Well, and you've done obviously very well in it with your company, but you've also done very well with this book. And I'm interested in that. Just, I have so many authors on this show. I mean, with the 1,500 whatever people who I've interviewed, there a lot of them are authors. And you have a Wall Street Journal and USA Today best-selling book, and that's not easy to do, especially with, you know, right out off the bat like that. What do you think was the unique thing about this book? Was it how you marketed it? Did you have a big following to begin with? I think a lot of people who listen want to know how you touched a nerve so much.
Yeah, it's a great question, and kind of just like, you know, any other, you know, success within a business, as kind of, you know, we're just talking about, it's a lot of things, of course, working together in an organized plan, and the center of that always is great people. Mm-hmm. And so we put a process in place. Certainly we did things of building a list, coming on great shows like this that have a following, to get the message out, you know, working and growing our email list, providing you know, in the beginning, providing, you know, free books in your initial launch week, you know, to pick up additional you know, buyers, engaging our 450 team members, employees, into the promotion through their social media and their networks, engaging our thousands of investors to get it out to their network. So active basic plan. We don't think we did anything earth shattering, but we did a lot of, you know, consistent activity. And then I will give credit. We used an organization that helped me through the putting the book together called Scribe. Mm-hmm. Was a good organization that helped us put the book together. And then we worked with an organization called Igniting Souls to help us with book promotion. And they've been phenomenal to work with, and are actually working with me on writing the next book that we're in process on right now, which is called Building an Elite Career, which is more for not for those who own the companies, but work within, you know, entrepreneurial organizations. So those are two great groups that were really powerful and helpful to us, Scribe and Igniting Souls, on helping us with the creation, publishing, and promotion of building an elite organization.
And you also created a companion elite journal to go with it, right?
Yeah, and that's been cool experience. Yes. Yeah. So the elite journal is kind of a way to kind of put the concepts of the elite execution system, or of what, you know, what I teach on in the book, into action. So at the end of the day, you know, a company, an organization, as we call it in title of the book, is a team of people. And in order to build an elite organization, you need you know, the people within your organization to operate in a disciplined manner. So it's about, you know, having success in business, being able to set, you know, in life, right, is being able to set clear goals and then be able to take disciplined, consistent action towards those goals. And that's what we teach, and how to put that in place within a company, within the building elite organization. And the journal is a way for every person within a company to kind of put that discipline into their own lives. So the elite journal, which is also, you know, we launched right after the book, has been phenomenal. And my chief experience officer, Patrick, did a lot of the work of creating this elite journal. We had hundreds of our team members test it and use it for many months and refine it before we formally launched it. And I spent, you know, a year and a half writing the book, and years, you know, learning and putting the systems and concepts behind the book in place. Yet very often I get even more positive feedback about how impactful the journal has been, which is a simple tool of, if you've ever read, you know, The Miracle Morning or, mm-hmm. or, you know, 5 a.m. Club, or the concept of first and foremost mastering your morning routine and starting your day with attitude of gratitude and writing down your big goals for the day and scribing throughout the day of what you accomplished, and just being a part of putting the habits in place of journaling. Mm-hmm. It's just really incredibly powerful. So the journal starts with, you know, laying out your big long-term goals, breaking it down to your annual, we call Living Fully dashboard, breaking it into your top priorities for the next 90 days, which we call ROCKS, which is a critical component of our elite execution system that the book is on, and then breaking it into weekly plans, and then your daily pages of journaling what you're going to accomplish, and what your wins are, what your lessons learned are, what you're grateful for, you know, each day. And the only way you can improve, you know, improve your performance, improve your life, is to change how you spend your time. And I think so many people who, very few overall people out there, really take the time to set real goals and write them down in a real disciplined way. But even those who get good at setting goals, where they usually fall short is then making sure that their schedule changes how they're spending their time in order to change the results that they're looking for. So that's where, you know, that's where the journal comes into play, is it helps you start reevaluating how you're spending your time and adjusting where you're putting your focus in order to get achieve the goals in all areas of your life that you're looking for. We call it the 8 F's of life, which are faith, family, friends, freedom, fun, fulfillment, fitness, and finance. And we want to help people be successful in all 8 of those areas, not just in their professional lives.
Well, you know, as I was looking through your book, I was interested by a lot of what you're talking about ties, you know, I love the journaling. I love all this that we're talking about because it ties into so much. I teach a lot of schools, and so I at different universities where we incorporate this information into class for especially entrepreneurs and different things. But I'm curious of some of the contents in your book, because a lot of it seems kind of intuitive. You're writing about mitigating risks and you know, execution and all that. But you got a couple chapters that I'm very curious about. What is WIGS about?
and I'm glad you said that. And a lot of what is in the book is, you said intuitive, or maybe not, maybe intuitive, maybe wouldn't be my first choice words, but it's stuff that's not the first time you ever heard before.
Well, I mean, the chapter titles kind of tell you what's coming is what I guess I meant by that. But WIGS, I don't know what's coming. What is coming in that chapter?
So WIGS, which is a concept we did not create, and that's where a lot of what's in the book, I give credit very quickly to the greats of Jim Collins and John Maxwell and Stephen A. Covey and Sean Covey. And Sean Covey is the person who created Wildly Important Goals, or WIGS. So there's a great book out there called 4 Disciplines of Execution, which is a book on WIGS, as you just referred to them, which is Wildly Important Goals. So a WIG is what is the number one priority within your team or your organization, that if you accomplish this, you know, kind of nothing else would matter, right? What is that big goal? And it's a discipline about getting everybody on that team working together in order to achieve that goal. And there's a very specific structure, 4 disciplines, to how you go about achieving your wildly important goals. And it's been unbelievably powerful for us and putting the right focus and attention around what's most important. And it's kind of a wildly important goal is about putting a little bit of your time around what's most important. It's not going to get you away from what we call the whirlwind of all the stuff that acts on you, all the stuff that comes at you all day, every day, that you have to react to. But putting a little bit of your time, and that's the key to success, putting a little bit of your time around on the most important things that you're going to act on is the difference maker in achieving your biggest goals. One of the great statements, which I think I learned from the book 4 Disciplines of Execution, is, you know, what's most important is rarely urgent. And what's urgent is rarely important. Of course, though, it always feels that way, right? And so, you know, and that's the tough thing, though, because proactive things that are really important, the things that are really important, you have to be proactive about. You have to act upon them. The things that are urgent that aren't that important, act on you. It doesn't take any work because you're just reacting to something that's acting on you. And so those are some of the concepts of wildly important goals.
Yeah, it's really interesting, because in some of my courses, I still teach the 7 Habits by Stephen Covey, and you know, being proactive.
Amazing, yeah.
Yeah, proactive was, I think, the first habit, wasn't it? And I think there's so much that you're covering that I think, you know, sometimes we read a little bit about something in somebody's book and you go, oh, well, that relates so well to what I'm looking at here. And I think I did the same thing with my books on curiosity and perception. I, you know, incorporated a lot of either Daniel Goldman's work on emotional intelligence or whatever it was, you know, that I was discussing. And I think we often find some parts to what other people write that they don't even, you know how much it influences us in a different way. So I love that's what that was. And rocks, tell me a little bit about the chapter on rocks.
Yeah, rocks are in many ways can seem very similar, and in some ways they are to WIGs or wildly important goals. Mm-hmm. But the simplest way I describe the importance of rocks. So we say in our organization, we accomplish more every 90 days than our competition accomplishes all year. And when you look at our results, you know, we've grown by over 60% every year for 15 years, meaning we're growing, you know, 10, 15% every 90 days, right? Which is, for most companies, would be great growth for a year.
Right.
And a big part of that is this simple concept of rocks. It's very simple, but there's certainly some really important components of it. So a rocker, what are your top priorities for the next quarter, the next 90 days? And in a company that runs our operating system, the lead execution system that the book is on, every person in the company will have three professional or rocks that apply to the company mm-hmm. every 90 days, and three rocks or top priorities that apply outside of work. Nobody okay. can have more, nobody can have less. So every person has three top professional rocks and three top personal rocks every 90 days. Hmm. And then kind of the magic to achieving rocks is that every other week, every two times a month, you have a milestone. And that milestone is what has to be accomplished in the next 2 weeks in order to achieve this 90-day top priority. And that's the area that really makes the difference, because right. you set a really important goal for 90 days. And, you know, we all get so busy that all of a sudden there's 3 weeks left in the quarter and you haven't done anything yet. But by having these milestones every 2 weeks that can be a mix between activity-based and results-based, that allows you to gauge and stay on track, really helps you stay focused and break it down into smaller priorities. And it's just, when done well, it's unbelievable how much you can get done, how many tremendous priorities. You think of an organization with 450 team members, every one of them having three company top priorities, you know, that's 1,350 priorities being achieved every 90 days. And of course, we don't achieve them all. We end up achieving our goal every quarter is to achieve 90% of them. We usually end up in the 80s. So we're far from perfect at it as a whole, but if you can achieve, you know, 80% of your top goals for the next 90 days within 90 days, and then most of the ones we miss, it's not that we didn't make any progress, we just didn't get it all the way done, and maybe it took another week or two or three. But that discipline is amazing. And it's also, what's incredible is, well, the part that gets me, that I get the most joy out of and the most that I just absolutely love is seeing people set their rocks outside of work. Mm-hmm. And seeing how it improves them, how they improve then as a father, as a mother, as a husband, as a wife, as a leader in their church, whatever is important to them, they transform their fitness or their health. And people first, when they join us, they think it might be, you know, it's just in, you know, hiring, you know, rah-rah, that we act like we care about what happens to you individually or what happens outside of work, when they realize, wait a second, you're holding me accountable to achieving my personal priorities. You're holding me accountable to losing weight or spending more time with my kids or, you know, whatever the case may be. It really also builds, you know, great deep relationships between our leaders and their team members and depth of that relationship. It's pretty amazing. And you see people who come into our organization in roles like construction or, you know, maintenance or, you know, frontline kind of coordinator roles, people who've never been involved in personal development or people coming to us in their 50s, 60s, 70s, even who this is completely foreign to, and just putting this into place and seeing the transformation in their lives is pretty awesome.
Well, I could see that there's so many people who could benefit from this, and I think a lot of people are listening to this and wanting to find you, your books, and all that. How could they find you and learn more?
Yeah, absolutely. So you can find the book, of course, anywhere you buy books, Amazon, Audible, Libro, which is the Audible competitor that we now use as our company because Audible stopped their business account. You can find me on any of the social media platforms, of course, and then my website for the book and everything related to this, the Elite Execution System, is dlpelite.com, dlpelite.com. And then my main company website is dlpcapital.com, dlpcapital.com.
Well, you've obviously done extremely well with that. I saw you have sold, you closed more than $4 billion in real estate transactions. So congratulations on the success of your company and the book. And it's just really interesting, Don. Thank you so much for being on today.
Hey, thank you, Dan, so much for having me.
Oh, you're welcome. And we'll be back right after this message. Curiosity is a critical and direct link to improving motivation and communication-based issues that challenge organizations. By improving workers' curiosity, you can enhance employee engagement, emotional intelligence, innovation, productivity, and many other byproducts that come with that intrinsic but underutilized attribute. To find out more about how to improve curiosity, please go to curiositycode.com. You know, I get so many great guests on the show. Sometimes I want to take some little bit of time to talk about some of the research I do. So I'm going to talk to you today about perception and some of the work I did with Dr. Maya Zilahich, who is also one of my people I've worked with at the Forbes School of Business. And she's been really great in this process of researching how, you know, perceptions process in our mind, our opinions and our version of the truth and our biases and how we live and, you know, what's in a rose? Well, would it smell as sweet by any other name and all that that we read about? And so we looked at what can we do with the perception in the workplace to discuss it, because we kind of looked at it as a combination of IQ, EQ, CQ for cultural quotient, CQ for curiosity quotient. And we thought, you know, I really think that this is something that they're not talking about enough in the workplace. So, you know, we talk about is perception reality, and to what extent are our perceptions true? Well, they're just our perceptions, right? But what is reality to us may not be reality to them. And so I think there is a truth to some extent, but what's real and all that, we started to get into this analysis paralysis thinking about it. And we thought, if we're thinking like this, we need to showcase what others have done to try and look at this, because the world's changing. We've seen The World is Flat by Thomas Friedman's great book, right? And we know that what we used to think is the reality of everything that we thought we could do, now it's different. We're becoming more connected, and we know that there's a lot more issues with the recent global tragedies. And so as companies are trying to do work in a global dot-com industry, it's just a lot different of how we look at things than when I originally got into the workplace or when Maya got into it. So we're looking at some of this, just our belief systems of what shape us, and both consciously and unconsciously, because if we know that, we can be more responsive and respond to this multicultural, multi-language world in which we're living. So if we can monitor our perceptions and guide them towards where we want to go or where we don't want to go, and understand what other people believe and maybe not necessarily agree with everything that they believe in, but that we, you know, we can understand that and see where they're coming from. And that's that way we manage our perceptions, and we're able to build empathy, which is a big part of emotional intelligence. And maybe, you know, you can't walk a mile in my shoes, but we can kind of have a better appreciation for what it would be like to do that. So we kind of looked at what was available in terms of assessments out there of how can we, like, test and validate and do all these things with that. And we came up with a perception power index, which goes along with the book, The Power of Perception. And those are the kinds of things that we're going to talk about today. I just think, you know, we come into this world with this predisposition of how we view and interpret things. I mean, imagine if you're born where you are now compared to if you were born somewhere else. I mean, we know that with twins, they're different if they were separated at birth. There's just a different upbringing. And so we have this cultural impact on how our behaviors, our beliefs, and everything that we relate to, it's impacted by our social and ethnic and age group, everything. And we're seeing that there's a lot more conflict right now in the world. And I think a lot of it is because we don't really understand each other that well. Something that we just don't even think about is acceptable or, you know, not questionable here in the United States might be something very questionable in another culture. If you're wearing a mini skirt in Brazil, is a lot different than if you're wearing that in Saudi Arabia, for example. So we have to appreciate where other people are coming from and see where maybe we're allowing our culture, our society dictate what we're thinking and what we're perceiving. I've had Joe Lurie on the show. He's got a great book, I should say, A Mind-Opening Journey Across Culture, where he talks about a lot of this, or writes about, I should say, all the different perceptions of things that he's found in different cultures, maybe like eye contact in Western cultures is maybe candor and confident. But you go to Africa, they don't want to do that because your eye contact with a person of authority, you got to worry about respect. And there's a lot of different issues when you're talking about Western culture versus other cultures. And in Asian cultures, they might use a calculator to negotiate price of things, but you might not want to do that in some other areas because it may seem disrespectful. So looking at different areas is really fascinating, just even how certain hand gestures mean one thing, may mean A-OK in one language and maybe be insulting in another language. So, or another culture, I should say. So a lot of studies look at Western culture versus other cultures, and I think that is worth reviewing. But now we know that, you know, there's a lot of stereotyping going on. We're trying to get away from that. We're trying to get away from biases. I mean, we have biases. Bo Lotto talked about that on my show. I hope you listened to that episode about how you need it. You know, you can't live without some kind of bias to give you some decision-making ability. But we have to pay attention to unconscious bias. And we got to be careful that we don't come across as arrogant or condescending. And, you know, just saying something, keep it simple, stupid, might mean one thing in one language. And, you know, we have that as a saying, and it's not meant to be insulting. But if you tell it to somebody else, it could be very insulting. So I think these are the kinds of things that we were looking at when we decided, you know, we needed to look at cultural quotients and IQ and CQ and, you know, our drive, our motivation, our knowledge, our cognition, our metacognition, and all those things to look at how we come up with these actions or behaviors. And do we have to adapt to customs, or should they adapt to ours, or should we be more tolerant of differences? And so I think, you know, change is a big thing that we teach in business classes, and being proactive to it is also important. And we know that we have these teams where there's in-groupers or out-groupers, and we want to try and get people to get along well. I know I've had Amy Edmondson talking about teams and teaming and how people get along, and a lot of it collaboration is about having curiosity to ask questions and learn from each other. So we want to look at the path that we're on that's similar, but also understand the path that we're on that's not so similar. And some of the things that impact that sometimes are things like spirituality, whether you're religious or not, it could be different. But some people, you know, have this impact of how important their spirituality or their religion is to them, where other people might be agnostic or atheist, and that could completely shape your whole perception of the situation at hand, where you might accidentally insult someone without even realizing it, of how important something is to them. And I don't think a lot of people give a lot of thought to the differences of how much strength that can have in their ideas and their things that they question or don't question. But it really can have a big impact, because we inherit a lot of beliefs from our family, and, you know, we personalize our beliefs. We take things that work for us, maybe don't work for us, and we make something around what works, you know, in our situation. And that can make us think we're right and they're wrong, and vice versa. So that is a problem in the business world if we don't examine what, you know, is shaping what these people are coming up with or not coming up with. And so having personalized beliefs are fine, but we have to recognize that, you know, even though Stephen Covey says, you know, spiritual renewal is one of the habits that are essential to effective leadership, we have to look at, you know, what's your greater purpose? What do they think is their greater purpose? And what are our values or our ethical principles? And what are theirs? And what will our legacy be? And what is theirs? And so those are the kinds of things that we researched in terms of, you know, how people use their religion, spirituality, and that. But it was also fun to look at gender to see the differences of how people look at paintings. There was a a comment we put in the book. Two strangers, a man and a woman, were visiting an art gallery and found themselves standing next to one another, staring at a painting of an old country estate, replete with an elderly man sitting in a rocking chair on a front porch of a mansion and with various barns and outbuildings and serving as background, right? The woman, without prompting, commented, "What a beautiful painting, so serene and peaceful, a beautiful blend of man and nature." The man commented in response, "That barn looks like it's in dire need of a paint job." Okay, so we both look at the same thing, but we see different aspects, right? There's not that one's right, one's wrong. It could be the opposite way around. It could be the man seeing the great thing, the woman saying the opposite. We don't want to stereotype necessarily, but it's interesting to see that men and women do see things a little bit differently. There are psychological differences in, you know, that these have been documented, including differences in their brains. So I think, you know, we hear gender bias, and we know studies show women viewed differently, treated differently, paid differently, and we know there's a predominance in the number of men compared to women in executive positions. And so those are the kinds of things that are really important to leaders to recognize, that we're talking about, you know, we have to know the origins of all this and why we see things through these different lens. And we know that men's brain is structurally different than the female brain. And that, I think that's kind of a fascinating thing to look at in itself. So we're not going to exactly see things in the same way. And there's a book, a New York Times bestseller, called The Female Brain. It's Dr. Luann, I hope I say her last name right, Brinzendine. She's a neuropsychiatrist, I believe. And, you know, there, she also later wrote The Male Brain. And so she guides you through the how the brains of each gender differ and how they shape our behaviors from the time we're infants all the way into adulthood. And the women's perceptions and behaviors are different to men's, mostly, she says, due to hormones. Which, you know, we do have different hormones. We know women have more estrogen, progesterone, even though we have testosterone, not as much as the men. And it goes all the way back to some of these hormones from, you know, that it's just how we are influenced by them. And I talked to Tom Peters on the show. That's a great show if you get a chance to look at it. And he talked about the female brain, and he recalled an article, I think it was from Duke University basketball coach Mike I never say his last name, Krzyzewski. Anyway, it was the Sunday Times magazine section. He described how that coach, often referred to as Coach K, would bring his wife to all the team meetings, and he said the reason was that she would see what was going on in the players' lives that he just didn't notice. She would notice a smell of a problem of a girlfriend 100 miles away or some kind of distraction, and he didn't think men psychologically saw those things, and he found it really fascinating as an observation. So I think, though, you know, there are differences, and if we pretend like we're not different, that doesn't work. We get uncomfortable, and if we look at that as one thing being better than another, that's also uncomfortable. So, but I think it's really important to just recognize that these things are part of us, that we're intended to be different. We're not intended to be exactly the same, and life be super boring if it was that way. So just thought that would be something that you talk about in the workplace, of what we can get. We know that the percentage of women in the workplace is increasing. We know that the rate of women occupying key roles in the workplace is on the rise. And we know that women are being hired into leadership roles more often than they were as CEOs, of course, at an increasing rate. We'd like to see it, of course, higher. And we know that women are bringing in different perceptions into the workplace. And then those are just different aspirations. So it is an interesting thing to look at, that how genetically wired we are, you know, we're wired differently right from the birth. And these differences are spawning this ground for this history of beliefs and stereotypes of how we're taught to view each other. And we're just carving a different road for ourselves, the women versus the men. And I think that's really important to know that we're evolving. And to do that, when we're doing that, we're impacted by our intelligence in this process. And if we look at intelligence, it's, you know, we talk about IQ and EQ, and if we're thinking of intelligence as what we know and how we apply what we know that we need to be able to use our intelligence to just understand how to relate with one another. We know that our intelligence evolves in different ways and our perceptions evolve in different ways. And so there's this perceptual intelligence of fluid versus crystallized intelligence comes about. And I think that there's some great work by Raymond Cattell, who talked about that. If you ever get a chance to read, you know, some of his work, I think that, you know, there's all these different types of how what we learn and how it changes over time is a very important thing to look at. Also, Howard Gardner's very heavily cited in the area of types of intelligence. And used to be we just thought we had one kind, right? But he studied all these different types of abilities that we have. I mean, you could have naturalistic intelligence, music's intelligence, logical mathematical intelligence, existential intelligence. Body, kinesthetic, verbal, linguistic, intrapersonal, visual, spatial intelligence, interpersonal intelligence. I mean, the list goes on and on. So I think that, you know, to say if somebody's smart is kind of a hard thing to do because there's these different types of ways of being smart. And then how do you value that intelligence and what's important in your culture for that type of intelligence? So that was interesting to us as we went through all the different ways that we grow and learn and just apply what we know. And then we also looked at emotions as in emotional intelligence in that aspect as well, because I had written my doctoral dissertation on emotional intelligence, and that's such a huge area. It was so great to have Daniel Goleman on the show to talk about emotional intelligence. And if you haven't listened to that episode, I highly recommend it. But emotions play a big part of how we make decisions. I mean, if you want to talk about empathy, is a big part of emotional intelligence. And if we have empathy, we ask, you know, sometimes that ties into curiosity, that we're asking questions to learn more about each other. And our emotions can be different across cultures. I mean, if you have you know, different studies between Japanese and American subjects, you know, they found facial expressions and nonverbal behaviors varied significantly between them. And, but it's interesting that certain emotions, I had Paul Ekman on the show, who the TV show Lie to Me was based on his work. There's certain expressions that we all make that are the same, whether you're blind or not. And I thought that was really fascinating. My father was born blind. So I really think it's interesting what things we have similar and then other things that are completely different. And it's just conceptually different based on the way you grow up and the influences around you of how you respond to your emotions. And your emotions can make you perceive failure differently either. And, you know, some of it, us have the fight or flight response. Some of us will, you know, run from it, or some of us will run to it. But most of us have that sense that failure is not your favorite thing, right? So our perception of failure can really influence how much we explore things and ask questions. It gets back into curiosity again. And I tell a story in my talks, and Maya and I write one in the book about just different experiences where sometimes you're in a sales presentation where you get your rear end handed to you, and you know, you might be on a call with your partner and your partner thinks it's the worst thing in the world, where you might think it's the best thing because you've learned everything you need to know now to fix your next presentation. And if you don't learn these things, sometimes your perception will get you down and you'll quit. So failure, you have to learn from failure, I think. And if you don't, you're going to end up being the glass half empty kind of person, and you won't move forward. You'll just stay where you are or move backward. And that's what we're trying to avoid by understanding perception. So the other things that we looked at when we were looking at perception was, you know, whether, again, if it's your reality or not. And I think that looking at some of the perception experts, especially Bo Lotto, I love his TED Talks. I know he was on the show and he talked about a lot of great things on the show. But if you're wanting to know perception versus reality, I would look at some of that because it's kind of fascinating. And I think talking about perception, you really need to talk about collaboration, because collaboration is a, you know, required skill set right now in the workplace. And if you're being hindered by your perceptions, there's so many variables, like, you know, think of the questions we ask ourselves. Does this project intrigue us? Does it motivate us? Do we like our teammates? Do we like our leader? Do we like the role we've been given? And you look at all this, and if you're getting mixed reasons for why you like something or don't like something, a lot of it could be your perception of it. When we talk about collaboration, I always think about Amy Edmondson's TED Talk, because that, of course, ties into how they got the Chilean miners out in that disaster. These people were able to work together and collaborate because they maybe had different perceptions, but they knew that it was like life or death, literally, in this case, to help people get out from under that rock. So I think understanding that perception is critical to collaboration and to getting people to work together and being innovative and creative is really interesting, because right now we're talking about how much we have problems with. Gallup says we're losing $500 billion a year on engagement. We know that people want to be collaborative. And if we don't have this ability to get along, that's going to be huge. And, you know, we want people to be creative and see things differently. I love, you know, in the Dead Poets Society movie, Robin Williams, you know, had the students get on top of their desk to look at life in a different way. And he said, to make life extraordinary, you have to make a difference, you must see things differently. And I think that that's a really key point, that a lot of people always are looking at things from their vantage point. They don't get on top of their desk. They don't look at things from another way. And I know I've done a lot of training classes where we've given Legos and we've had people build things as teams in collaborative ways. And it's just fun to see them get ideas from each other and go, huh, I would have never looked at it that way. And if you maybe aren't a big fan of teams, sometimes it's really helpful to get on a team with people who are completely different than you are. Because if everybody thinks the same way, life's really boring. And it helps to look at things from a critical thinking standpoint, to do research. How do these people do this? How have they made it successful? What facts support their argument? What's the source of their information? And how did they come to that conclusion? And then we're back to curiosity again. And I think that those are the kinds of questions we need to ask ourselves. And I don't think we get enough of that. I think that there's a lot of people who just want to take things at face value based on what they've always known and what supports their values that they've always had. And that's kind of common for people. I mean, you watch the same either CNN or Fox or whatever that supports your values because it makes you comfortable. But it really is important to get curious and kind of get outside. You know, our perception suggests we know something, but our curiosity proves that we don't, right? So we need to know what we don't know. And I think a lot of people aren't asking enough questions. And that's the kind of thing that in the book, Cracking the Curiosity Code, it's a huge part of changing the culture in organizations. And I often talk a lot about that to groups, because if we can ask more questions, we can get better at decision making. And so it's, you know, decision making can be really challenging. I love a quote by Deepak Chopra where he says, if you obsess over whether you're making the right decision, you're basically assuming that the universe will reward you for one thing and punish you for another. If you think about that, you always think you have the right or the wrong thing, right? But it's not necessarily the case. There's shades of gray. Not everything is black and white. And that's what I find particularly fascinating in the research that we did. And, you know, if we're trying to fix all the things in work, we're trying to fix engagement. I mentioned before that you're losing 500 a year, according to Gallup, that, you know, when people are financially invested, they want to return, right? But when people are emotionally invested, they want to contribute. And so that's what we need to do, is get people emotionally invested at work and contributing. And part of that is to ask questions and to understand each other better. And then if you're asking questions, again, we're back to empathy, which is a big part of emotional intelligence. And then we're getting that perception of the other person's ideas. And we're seeing it not just from our own standpoint, but from theirs. And I think that to improve some of the questions that we need to ask to improve engagement are like, do my employees feel they're growing in their work? Are they being recognized for their work? Do they trust the company's on the right track. And so those are some of the things that lead to really great communication. I had Kevin Cruz on the show, and he has a great book and information about engagement. And I think that that's really helpful. And all this is so that we can be better leaders, right? And better employees, both. And I think that we have to sometimes suspend our beliefs and be agile and, you know, look in some of the words that we hear a lot about vulnerability. You know, Brene Brown has made a lifelong career out of that. And I think that a lot of people don't feel comfortable doing that. So that's what led to our interest in maybe, you know, looking at what the perception process is and how can we manage our perceptions. And so we looked at, you know, creating an assessment would be important and kind of an epic decision of, you know, how can we help people understand what they go through? What does the process look like? And we found it's about evaluating, predicting, interpreting, and, you know, reshaping or actually correlating one's perceptions. And so the EPIC acronym we came up with is evaluation, prediction, interpretation, and correlation. And those are the things that if you take the perception power index that you will find out, how are you doing in those areas? What could you do to improve your EPIC process? And, you know, I think it's very similar to if you've taken the Curiosity Code Index. It's very simple. You get your results right away, and you can find out a lot more about how well you go through this process and what kinds of things are holding you back. Because if you get a baseline of, okay, so this is how I am at this, then you know how to move forward. Let's just look at some of these, because evaluation, you know, you're going to examine, you're going to assess, and you're going to do a lot of these different things that you can recognize if you're open to thoughts or ideas. You kind of look at it from your own perspective of your self-awareness. I kind of think of this one as more that in that respect. And if you apply this element of emotional intelligence, this self-awareness, then you're going to get along better and you're going to be able to be more aware of how you come across to other people, because that's a lot of a problem. I see a lot of people don't recognize body languages or issues or tone or if they're typing in all caps. There's all these different things they can do of how they come across and they don't realize it. And then they can predict how the other person's going to ask and act. And then in a way, that's another part of emotional intelligence, is their interpersonal awareness of are they able to understand the other person's, where they're coming from, what their perception is and their capabilities and their abilities and how they make decisions. And that is very challenging to predict what other people are going to do if you don't look into what they're doing and have empathy and ask questions and have that sense of emotional intelligence. And it's only then that you can make your interpretation. And your interpretation, you have to consider how all of this impacts their decision of how the curiosity comes into this. You know, you're making assumptions and you're looking at how their fear is impacting them. And I think a lot of this really ties back into their culture of how were they raised. And we know that behavior and different things are rewarded or not rewarded in certain systems. And so we need to look at that. How did their culture shape them? And how did the company culture shape them? So I think it's about assessing and understanding your own emotions for the EPIC part. But the I part, that part is more about putting it collectively together and to interpret what you know. And then you end with your conclusions, your correlation is your final C of the EPIC process. Because now that you have all this, you can come up with your solutions, your conclusions. After researching your facts, this is kind of the critical thinking aspect of it all. And, you know, we know that there's so many great ideas that come out. But if, you know, you don't go to the part where you end it with coming up with the idea, with actually taking what you've learned in this group setting and changing a little bit of your behavior so you can have a win-win situation, you haven't come to any kind of conclusion that's going to be good for everybody. So I think that those are some of the main points that we make in what we're talking about in this EPIC process, in this power of perception. And I thought that this would be something really critical to share. You can take the Perception Power Index at drdianehamilton.com, and all the assessments are there. You can take the Curiosity Code Index, you can take the Perception Power Index, you can even take a DISC and emotional intelligence test. A lot of that is all there. If you don't see it in the drop-down menus at the top, there's more menus at the bottom. And I hope you contact me if you have any questions, and I hope that this helps you understand perception a little better. Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate. Well, I'd really like to thank Don for being my guest today. We get so many great guests on this show. If you've missed any past episodes, you can go to drdianehamilton.com. And if you go to the blog, you can actually read the show in addition to listening to it. So I hope you take some time to do that. And I hope you join us for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio.